The previous speaker, Mark van Zande, started his presentation with the first statement, we are a global materials company. In the same vein, I can say Siemens is not a global materials company. So of course the question is, why bother about NMP topics? Why am I supposed to talk about this topic here? Why have we, Siemens, for instance, chosen to become a member of this Energy Materials Initiative Association, which Mark van Zande just mentioned briefly in his presentation? Why all that? And I can tell the reason is very simple, and the reason was stated very accurately by Mr. von Bose. There is no party without materials, and be sure, we Siemens, we also want to party. And we also want to party in Europe. So this is why I'm very happy that I have this opportunity here today to share some of our views on the NMP topics today. And I would like to kick this off with the inevitable slide on megatrends and grand challenges. And rest assured, this is the only slide I'm showing in this context. And I'm only showing this because I would like to point out that the megatrends as we see them, like urbanization, demographic change, climate change, globalization, are nicely mapping into our four business sectors. The urbanization is being dealt with in the infrastructure and cities sector, which we founded just about 9 months ago. Demographic change is all these challenges are being addressed by the healthcare sector. Climate change is mostly or significantly related to energy generation, so this is the task of our energy sector, and globalization is more or less related to industry. When you take a close look at what you actually got to do in order to launch innovations in all these domains, it quickly turns out that there's a lot of material solutions required. And the list speaks for itself, and I'm not going to address every single topic on this list here. There's simply not enough time within 15 minutes. But let me just look at a few examples, which I will then explain a little bit more detail later on in the presentation. So for instance, for power supply, no matter whether it's renewable energy sources or whether it's the more traditional fossil energy resources, you always need one or the other kind of a unique material solution, maybe coating solution, whatever. Same for efficient energy usage, for affordable and personalized healthcare. We have some focus on novel radiation detectors, but also biomarkers for gene sequencing or for highly efficient diagnostics in the lab are of the essence. For industrial production and service, additive manufacturing, this is one of the examples where I will dwell a little bit on the link from material to efficient manufacturing, which is quite important, and I will probably not be able to get into this simply due to the time constraints here. So let me start with sustainable power supply. And of course, we would all be more than happy to cover all of our power needs, all of our energies with just renewable energies like wind, solar, thermal and photovoltaics. However, in reality, this may be possible when the winds really blow and the sun shines 8 or 10 hours a day. But in reality, we still need backup from more conventional power sources like the coal-fired power plants, like hydropower plants, and of course nuclear is very controversial, so I don't take a further look at that. And so this will furnish the low emissions base load, hopefully low emissions as low as possible. And then of course we need a backup to cover mid and peak loads, and this is typically being covered by gas-fired combined cycle power plants. We could reduce the need for the peak load coverage here if we would have more efficient energy storage, means for energy storage, but this is, I have to say, still in the making, and there's much more work to do in order to be able to store all the excess power that is being generated, say here in Denmark, which is a typical example, with massive installations of wind turbines, the excess power that cannot be be used, how to store it, that is another key challenge which I'm not able to address here today. So what we are really looking at is to increase the power output and the efficiency and cut the building cost to meet the cost targets and typical numbers, typical ballpark numbers that we have accomplished today is for the combined cycle, which is the best efficient topic conversion that we have, up to 63%, which is quite an accomplishment. So let me talk a little bit about the compensated mid-peak load gas turbines. I think the key enabler is really the materials here, simply because the efficiency is directly related to the operating temperature. The higher the operating temperature, the higher the efficiency, a very basic thermodynamic principle. So there has been a relentless search for higher temperature materials. On one hand, of course, for the blades, the blade material itself, which is usually a super alloy. And then, of course, in order to even increase the temperature resistance, the blades are being covered by so-called thermal barrier coatings with a very low heat conductivity. And these are ceramic barrier coatings. And this is a very, very important and significant USP that the various manufacturers of such gas turbines have. The quality, the lifetime, the endurance of those barrier coatings, and of course, at the end of the day, also the manufacturing cost. I mean, of course, with endless resources and no limits concerning cost, you can accomplish almost everything. But in order to really aim for a reduction in operating expenses, not an increase in operating expenses, you have to use the most sophisticated methods to develop such coatings and also to develop the processing and manufacturing methods for those coatings. So much for the fossil. Then, of course, here in Denmark, I can't get away without making a quick comment about the wind energy, the wind turbines. Here's the latest innovation that our wind power division, which is actually headquartered in the neighborhood here, has launched. This is a gearless 6-megawatt wind turbine with really impressive specifications here, like the tower head mass 350 tons and the blade length in this configuration, 75 meters, which is the longest blade length that we have achieved so far. And there's two key innovations that have enabled us to launch this product here. One is the direct drive in the generator. That means there's no gearbox necessary anymore in the nacelle, which really reduces weight significantly. And the other one is a unique blade manufacturing technology, which allows us to manufacture the blades or to realize the blades with much lower weight than any other competing technology. Depending on what you compare it with, this 75 meters blade is 25 to 50% lighter than competing solutions. And of course, this has a massive impact on the total weight of the whole turbine, of the whole product here. And less weight means simply less expensive nacelles, less expensive towers, less expensive bed blades, bottom line, much reduced cost, and a very, very big step towards meeting the cost position of today's fossil energy generation. Now that we have the energy, we should make the most efficient use out of it. And I'm looking at just one example in this context here, and that is lighting. And the reason being fairly simple, according to a research done by the DOE a couple of years ago, 10% of all electricity generated in the US is being used for incandescent lighting. So there's huge savings potential because the light bulb is known to be notoriously inefficient, and solid state lighting is on its way to change the whole situation, and the first retrofits for light bulbs based on LEDs, on luminescent diodes, you can already buy them in the typical supermarket or Home Depot kind of store. The next generation is going to be organic LEDs, and the operating principle is exactly the same as for the traditional LEDs. You have an anode, you have a cathode, you have electrons and holes traveling from the electrodes here and meeting somewhere in between, recombining, and then light is being generated. The only difference is we are not talking about gallium arsenide or related materials here, we are talking about organic materials. So the basic principle being very simple, the actual implementation already looks much more complex, especially if you want to generate nice warm white light like what you're being used to. So we have typically seven organic layers, typical thickness less than 10 nanometers. How do you control the accuracy in that range? How do you make sure you really hit the optimum in terms of material usage, in terms of efficiency? And how to choose the material combinations, who develops all those interesting materials, certainly not we ourselves, certainly only in collaboration with competent partners throughout Europe. And that is the only way to make sure that we can meet the requirements for typical key performance indicators like the efficiency, like the lifetime, like the color rendering index, and also color rendering index stability over time. You don't want a light source that changes its color as time goes by. So we are just at the very beginning of a revolution to come, we think. Right now the market entry has happened, and but of course this is not yet a competitive product price-wise. This is more like when you're buying a very fancy product, like when you're buying say a Rolls-Royce or so. So it's really an emotional product, and it has its niche market, but this is not really what we are looking for on the mid or long term. On the midterm, I think for the next 3 to 4 years, we will certainly build on interesting features like flexible light sources, bendable light sources, transparent light sources, and so which will pave the way for new applications and which will really stir up the creativity of architects. And the mass market, the volume business, we expect that not to happen before 2016. But in order to get there, again, we need to master material development, the device physics, process development, and upscaling. I mean, and this is a topic already also being addressed briefly, I believe, in the previous presentation, pilot lines. Pilot lines of the essence, pilot lines which can quickly transfer the results from R&D into a first prototyping and then hopefully upscaling mass production. Okay, let's make a switch, shift gears to healthcare. But even then, I have the opportunity to stay within this domain of organic electronics. Now we are just doing the opposite. We are not generating light, we are harvesting light. And we are doing this for X-ray imaging. Usually X-ray imaging or X-ray detection is being done in a two-step process. First you convert the X-ray photon into a visible photon. This is being done by the so-called scintillator here. And then the visible photon is being detected in this case by an organic photodiode. The more traditional, the very traditional means of doing this is using an image intensifier. This technology has been around for 30 years and is on its way out. The state-of-the-art technology is detecting the photon with amorphous silicon detectors, and this is widespread now actually, so-called flat X-ray detectors, flat panels, and we think replacing the amorphous silicon where do I have it? Amorphous silicon by organic photodiodes will come with quite significant advantages, simply because the whole structure is much easier to manufacture. The key material here are buckyballs and this P3HT polymer, because this charge separation, the electron hole separation, happens here, and the fullerenes are extremely electronegative. They have a very high electron affinity, so they immediately capture the electron, and so the whole structure, the sole as we call it, the bulk heterojunction, has a very high efficiency in terms of a conversion rate. Now, the advantage compared to the amorphous silicon is much fewer processing steps, only one step where lithography is involved, which is usually cumbersome and expensive. There's easy depositing of organic layers just by spray coating, and higher throughput. The only caveat is the OPDs typically have a higher dark current, but they still may have sufficient and acceptable specifications for what we call cost-effective X-ray imaging, lower cost products, and this is an example here of the phantom of a hand. So basically it works. The question is, again, also now to us, how can we transfer this into a real product innovation, and we are working on that. Industrial production and service, even more focusing on manufacturing. This is my last topic here, additive manufacturing. A very popular topic in some circles, I must say. And the method of choice here, which we are pursuing, is a so-called selective laser melting. So what you effectively do is you have a sort of powder bed, and you have a scanning laser beam which scans across the surface in a defined pattern. And wherever the laser beam has been, the powder melts and solidifies, and where it hasn't been, it just stays as powder. Then you put another layer of powder on it, and by doing this step by step, you can build up very complex structures, either very hollow structures here like this one, or these ducts here, transition ducts, which are used in some of our products. And why is this so interesting? Well, of course, it's really material efficient, very material efficient. It's much more material efficient than any subtractive method like milling and cutting and dicing, because the powder that is not being used, the powder that is not being solidified, you just recollect it, recycle it, and you can use it for the next piece to manufacture. You have much more freedom regarding the shapes that you can realize, and lightweight structures. I mean, this is really a very light structure, and well, quite frankly, a topic, an opportunity that looks for an application. Yeah, one application that we have in mind here is in the white goods industry. This is a tumble dryer here, and there's a motor, and this is the pedestal for the motor which holds it. The vibrations cause some oscillations here, and this is a part which once in a while breaks. So the company has to keep a lot of spare parts in store, and the idea here is to replace this, not to keep the spare parts in store, but rather to manufacture on demand. When a spare part is needed, fire up your laser melting machine, your laser sintering machine, and you manufacture one part. And we have decided not just to make a one-to-one replacement, but also to integrate an additional function, because there's in the conventional design, there's a little rubber block which dampens the oscillations, obviously not sufficiently enough, otherwise the whole thing wouldn't break. We have integrated that function into a more smart design of this pedestal, which looks like this. So we have a mechanical damping feature rather than this rubber damping. And so I think a very smart solution. And we look forward to, well, trying this actually out in the field, this whole concept. By the way, this is the only example in my long list of examples where we were lucky to receive, you can see it here from the logo, funding from the FP7. And this again sort of addresses the same issue that Mark van Zande already addressed. From our point of view, the FP7 simply is too much orientated, too much focused on basic research rather than applied research like this one here. Okay, so a few minutes for my conclusions. Why play nanomaterials and production a role in the Siemens strategy? Well, of course, we are a system solution provider, but nevertheless, we need to have also the competency, the in-house competency, to develop our own material innovations, and either by ourselves or in collaboration with competent partners. And this is simply because these innovations are so essential to generate USPs for our products. We cannot leave this just to suppliers, as I might say, at least not for the complete value chain. So when I look at the value chain, there's of course the initial materials, there's the materials engineering, and then there's the components, the systems and the business. And you see the various players, the various stakeholders involved. We have the external suppliers, R&D partners, for the whole value chain. Our central organization, the corporate technology, is more or less involved. But of course, the further down it goes, the Siemens business units come into play. And of course, also customers. Customers are very important, and there's no good, no well-organized funded project without a customer in the boat, because the customer really has the best view on the most profitable applications. So last slide here, the successful strategies. We have to use system application know-how in order to really focus on the best opportunities. We need the in-house expertise, I mentioned that. We need to establish strategic partnerships with institute and companies. And by the way, with both Umicore, which was the first presentation, as well as with Materialize, which is the last presentation in the session here, we do have very well-defined collaborations in the context of funded projects. So yeah, this is the funded projects topics. And so at the end of the day, I think this gives us a great opportunity to improve the important key performance indicators, like you can read them here on the short list on the right hand side. And since time is up, I just have a chance to present my acknowledgements to both the BMBF and to the European Commission. But needless to say, we benefit much more from the BMBF, most noticeably in the context of the WING program, which is known to some of you here in the room, than from the FP7. Thank you very much for your attention.